My name is Dr. Erica Lehman in the LA area, and I'm a board certified ophthalmologist. I'm trained in corneal transplant surgery and refractive surgery and infectious diseases. I went to medical school at Northwestern University. I did my internship in ER medicine and internal medicine at USC. And then I did my residency at University of Chicago. And I did my surgical training and surgical fellowship at LSU. When I was there, actually, I also did some research for the FDA. I was involved in the FDA trial for the excimer laser and published several articles and some chapters pertaining to infections. I've been treating tick-borne illnesses for over 11 years now. And it's the most rewarding and the most challenging work that I've done. So when it comes to Lyme disease, there's a vast array of symptoms. And some of those symptoms include symptoms regarding the eye. So there's many ophthalmic manifestations. So initially, I was seeing many patients that were referred to me who had Lyme disease, and they also had problems with their vision. But a lot of patients get migraines, they get ocular migraines, and it's very common, the visual issues, and they come and go. And refractive errors change, so patients will find that their glasses don't work anymore one day, and then the next week they put on their glasses and the vision is fine and crisp, but depending on how sick they are and how inflamed they are, the glasses don't work. It could be things that they had double vision, it could be blurry vision, it could be dry eyes, it could be soreness, it could be red eyes, chronic infections, images moving. So I was initially taking care of all of their ophthalmologic issues, and then it started to spread into addressing their other symptoms, because then the patients would tell me about other symptoms that weren't resolving with the treatments that they were getting. And I wanted them to feel better and I wanted them to not suffer and have relief. So I slowly started to dedicate myself just to Lyme disease patients. Lyme disease is caused by an infection due to a bacteria. And the bacteria is called Borrelia burgdorferi. It's a corkscrew-shaped bacteria and it's primarily caused by a tick bite, but you can get it other ways. You can be born with it. It's passed through placental tissue into the bloodstream of the mother and to the child. It can also be found in transfusions. So unfortunately, in hospitals when patients receive blood transfusions, the blood is not screened for Lyme disease. It's the fastest growing epidemic in the world. It's faster growing than hepatitis, then breast cancer, and then HIV. So a tick bite is normally not known by the patient. When a tick bites you, there's an anesthetic in its saliva and also an anticoagulant in its saliva. So when you're bitten, you won't necessarily know that you're bitten, especially if it's on the back of your body somewhere. It numbs your skin and you don't know it's there. If you're lucky enough to get a bullseye rash, which doesn't happen all the time, then you would know for sure that you have Lyme disease. But that rash is also transient. So if it's somewhere on the back of your body, you may not even see the rash. Or if it's on your hairline, you're not necessarily going to see the rash because it doesn't stay for a long period of time. If you have a bullseye rash, most people realize, they know that that's Lyme disease. But the rash can also take on other different configurations. It doesn't have to be your perfect classic bullseye rash. It can be homogeneous. It can be confluent, meaning it can all be red and connected. It doesn't have to have necessarily distinct borders. It can have streaks. So there's many, many different appearances of this rash. The percentages also in terms of when you're bitten and if you're going to get an EM rash, which is a bullseye rash, they vary. It can vary anywhere from 15 to 63% according to the CDC. And it varies according to demographic distribution, according to gender, according to age. If you do get a tick bite, the tick doesn't always carry the bacteria. And depending on where you are in the country, some ticks are more likely to carry the bacteria than not carry it. So it's not a guarantee that you're going to get Lyme disease. The other main concern is when you're bitten by a tick, there are other things that the tick carries. So a tick is like nature's dirty needle, and it feeds off of lots of different animals. It'll feed off of mice and rats and squirrels and deer and lots of animals whose blood is not clean. So ticks carry it. They will feed off an animal, and then they'll pass that as well to the animal. And then another insect will feed off of an animal. It's an ancient bacteria. It's been around for millions and millions of years. And there's something important to note that people are under the misconception that when a tick attaches and starts to take a blood meal from a person or a patient, that it needs to be attached for a particular amount of time. And that's just an old wives' tale. A tick doesn't know how to tell time. And they don't decide at 48 or 72 hours that they're now going to put the bacteria into the person's bloodstream. So there are some studies that show within 20 minutes of a bite that the bacteria can enter a person's body and cross the blood-brain barrier. So the Lyme bacteria, Borrelia burgdorferi, does a number of things. So it has direct effects on the brain and it has indirect effects on the brain. And one of the things it does is it causes inflammation in the central nervous system. And so you have an increased permeability or a leaky brain as a result. And so the bacteria can reach the brain. One of the other important points to note is that when a tick feeds off of an animal, it's not just the Lyme bacteria that we worry about, because these animals also carry viruses and they carry parasites and all different types of bacteria. So all of these other infections, we call them co-infections. Co-infections make it harder to treat Lyme. Those patients are usually a lot sicker, and those are the patients that will frequently relapse. They also don't check, the blood bank doesn't check for these co-infections. There have been some recent articles about some states starting to check for one of these infections called babesia. And babesia is a parasite, and it lives inside of red blood cells. And it's one of the co-infections of Lyme. And you can get this through transfusion.